Hello everyone, this is MJ with MinIO. In this part of the course, we're going to be doing a Kubernetes overview, and we're going to be talking about how Kubernetes works in certain areas and some of the key aspects of Kubernetes, as well as how that relates to what the MinIO operator actually deploys within Kubernetes. So first off, what is Kubernetes? Kubernetes is a portable, extensible, open source platform for managing containerized workloads and services. Basically, if you've ever run a Docker host, Kubernetes takes that and extends it out and makes it very pluggable so that you can add different elements into it very easily. And there's a large ecosystem of products out there that you can add on for many different things like storage or ingress into your cluster or networking and all those kind of things. It really facilitates declarative configuration and automation. So declarative meaning that you can write out some code in YAML and commit that to your code repository, and you can declare what you want it to deploy, and it will actually go in and make that happen on the cluster. And it's a very large and rapidly growing ecosystem. The value of Kubernetes is really that it's a scalable framework for running distributed systems resiliently. So what that means is if you are running multiple nodes and one of those nodes goes down, Kubernetes will automatically move your workloads over to another node and allow those services to continue to be presented to your end users, whoever they are, without any disruption. And then you can go and troubleshoot in the background on why there was a failure in the cluster, but your services will still be up and running. And Kubernetes completely handles scaling and failover for your application and provides specific deployment patterns to be able to easily upgrade certain workloads. And if that doesn't work, then you can easily roll back. You can have different A/B deployments and things. So we won't be going into all that in this course. We're just gonna go high level, but I highly recommend that you dig into a lot of the capabilities of Kubernetes if you're looking for more complex deployments. So why do we need Kubernetes and containers? Really the key capabilities here are service discovery, load balancing, storage orchestration, automated rollouts and rollbacks, automatic bin packing, self-healing and secrets, and configuration management. So really everything that you would have to do on a VM or a physical machine when you were just running Linux, you'd have to update certain packages, you would have to make sure that there were no conflicts on those systems. By bringing all of those elements inside the container and making that portable around your infrastructure, you will really be able to easily port that into different systems, whether it's different cloud providers or other deployments that you're doing on premise. And you will be able to now really scale that out very easily without a lot of manual work on those systems. So in this part of the course, we're going to talk about Kubernetes architecture, and we're going to cover some of the basics here of the architecture, specifically as they relate to MinIO. So we're going to discuss the following concepts. We're going to talk about what Kubernetes namespaces are. We're going to discuss Kubernetes pods, which is sort of the smallest individual compute unit that you can run inside Kubernetes. We're going to talk about how deployments can deploy multiple pods and sort of manage the lifecycle of all of those pods. We're going to talk about what stateful sets and daemon sets are. They're a special type of deployment. We're going to talk about services. Think of services as a load balancer with inside the cluster. And there's also different types of services. So there's cluster IP, which is internal to the cluster only. And there's node port services, which expose a high ephemeral port outside the host. We're going to talk about persistent volumes and persistent volume claims. Those are what you will use for storing all of your MinIO data. We'll also talk about storage classes for different types of storage. So let's say that you had some SSDs for really fast storage or NVMe storage, but also you have some hard disk storage that is obviously much cheaper and also has larger storage capacity. Maybe you'll put some workloads on your really fast storage for things that you need to be high performance, and maybe you'll put archive things into the hard disk storage. And lastly, we'll talk about ingress, which is specifically used for basically pointing DNS names at your cluster and being able to have that route automatically inside your cluster to the appropriate endpoints, whether that be your MinIO management console or any of your tenants inside your cluster. Here's a high-level Kubernetes architectural diagram. So the main program that you'll be using to sort of manage your clusters will typically be kubectl. Or kubectl. That will call into the kube API. So everything inside Kubernetes is an API call, and it's all managed by the Kubernetes API controller. There's also a scheduler, which makes sure that the workloads that you've defined that need to be running are always running and always available with inside your cluster. etcd is sort of the key value store database that keeps all the configuration in check and manages all that within Kubernetes. And then there's the Kube Controller Manager, which is basically responsible for managing all the aspects of the Kubernetes cluster as it relates to the nodes. Within each node, you'll find a kubelet, which is basically communicating back to the API and make sure that it knows what it should be running on that particular node. There's a proxy. So if someone comes into your environment and they hit a load balancer and they hit a proxy on one of the nodes that is not running the workload that you want, it will automatically route that traffic to the appropriate node that does have your workload, and the end user won't know the difference. They'll just reach the page that they expected to reach. This is all managed internally by IP tables on Linux. Then there's a container runtime. This is container D typically. Even Docker has rebased to container D, so that will be your container runtime. Basically, that's what's providing the capability for containers to run in your Linux system. And then there are your workloads, which are, in this case, pods that are running on top of your cluster. Thanks for joining us for this Kubernetes overview topic as part of the MinIO on Kubernetes and MinIO Operator course. We look forward to seeing you in the next video. Thanks and have a good one.